The last couple of versions of Python have featured alternate builds of the language with free threading, which allows threads in Python to run with full parallelism instead of being serialized to the interpreter. I've talked before about how promising this is and how it's going to take some time to be fully embraced by the Python community. Some things may have to be rewritten, other things rethought entirely. Now, the other month, at the 2025 Python Language Summit in Pittsburgh, one of the talks was about fearless concurrency, about the future of Python as it moves towards a free-threaded future. And some of the stuff that they touched on was interesting and important enough that I want to go into detail about it and unpack it here. Now, one of the pitfalls of threading in Python, according to the presenters, is that you don't have good information about when an object is shared across multiple threads. It's hard to detect what are called Datarace conditions, where objects are modified by multiple threads in a way where the order of the modifications can't be guaranteed. Now, how do we detect and prevent something like that in a language as fundamentally dynamic as Python? And my thought was, can this even be done in Python? Wouldn't we be better off choosing another language entirely for something with those kinds of requirements, like Rust, for instance? On the other hand, I love that Python's team wants to see what's possible and not leave potentials for improvement off the table. So one of the proposals raised for how to solve this problem uses what's called a region model for Python objects, and it's all being done under the code name Lungfish. And the idea behind a region is that it's a way to gang together a group of mutable objects in Python so that they have to be handled as a group. Anything that wants to work with objects in the region has to become part of the region, and once it's done with that work, it can be released from that region. Now, if this sounds a lot like the way reference counting works for garbage collection, you're right. It's essentially the same idea, expanded to cover how data access is serialized between objects. And like reference counting, it's handled entirely by the runtime. The end user does not need to make any changes to their program. And the same was true for the vast majority of programs that used high-level threading abstractions like thread pools. They work as is for the free-threaded version of Python. The proposal does also allow for regions to be created manually, but the core concept should work automatically. Now, so far, all of this only exists as a proposal in the abstract. Actually, it's a set of four proposals, each of which provides a different piece of the puzzle. The first is what's called deep immutability. Another is for modifying garbage collection and reference counting for immutable objects. A third is around sharing data for immutable objects between threads and subinterpreters. And the fourth is about sharing mutable data between regions. You see how each of these build on top of each other. The later proposals depend on the earlier ones, and that's why they're being worked on and submitted in that order. But even if only the first couple of these ideas get accepted for now, that adds some really powerful features to Python at a low level that we haven't yet had, like concepts for how immutable objects can be extended. There were some formal proposals for this sort of thing some time ago. One was called the Freeze Protocol, but that was proposed and rejected about 20 years ago. And the discussion around how to handle lifetimes and accessibility of Python objects has advanced enormously since then. It's become even more important to try and think about how these things could be used to make Python both faster and more reliable. Another thing worth noting about this idea is how it took some inspiration from concepts in other languages, but didn't try to crowbar them into the way Python does things. See, in Rust, there's this concept of ownership, which prevents things from being mutated by mistake. But adopting Rust's way of doing things in Python would have forced pretty much all of the existing code that we have to be rewritten. And that kind of splintering happened before when we had to switch from Python 2 to Python 3. And the Python world has good reason not to let something that divisive happen again. Adopting something like an explicit concept of ownership or borrowing, as per Rust, in Python would have polarized things big time. People just want existing Python code to continue working predictably whenever possible. And that's made it challenging to roll out these kinds of big transformative changes to the language. But to the extent that's already happened, it's been a really impressive achievement. So what's next for this whole bag of ideas? Well, first come the four proposals that I outlined earlier, and the time frame for that is probably going to go into a few years, meaning it's going to stretch over at least a couple of versions of Python. None of this is happening in the near term. And along the way, they're going to need to sort out a lot of hard, unanswered questions about how these ideas are going to fit into the rest of the Python ecosystem. It's not something that can just be dropped in and expected to work. So don't wait for anything concrete to come along too soon. But of all of the ideas currently being considered for Python's future, this is one I'm going to be keeping eyes out for very closely. It has a lot of possible impact. So that's it for this episode. If you liked it, leave a comment below, and don't forget to follow Dev with Sirdar and InfoWorld on Facebook, YouTube, and InfoWorld.com.